Well, absolutely. Just look at the titles of Ray Kurzweil's books about singularity. Singularity is near. Even the language which is being used is the language of the messianic, of end of the world, a religious language, dogmatic language. I mean, and they're not even, he's not, of course, if you ask him, he would probably deny it. But at least that consciously or unconsciously, the language, the words, the manner of approaching the world that I hear betrays that dogmatic thinking. Now, when you say singularity movement, I'm not sure. I think there is some diversity. So in other words, I don't want to lump people together. And one could be, I suppose that the concept itself is not perhaps so well defined. So I don't want to appear as if I am sort of painting everybody with one color. But the more well-known branch, let's just say, people who like Kurzweil, who are well-known sort of prophets of singularity, the surely the language, the structure, the approach is undeniably reminiscent of organized religion. This is what I think, consciously or unconsciously, that movement led by these people is starting to look like more and more. Well, there are several layers here, so there are several important points. And one is, one I think which is most important in some sense is why somebody like Kurzweil or other proponents of singularity, transhumanism, strong artificial intelligence, why is it, what is the mechanism, what makes them so caught up in the web of these ideas, in these beliefs that humans are nothing but machines, because that's what ultimately these ideas betray. The ideas betray that everything, life is an algorithm. A human is ultimately a sequence of zeros and ones. It can be programmed. It's just that we don't have right now enough computational power. But as soon as we do, and his argument is very clever, because if you subscribe to the idea that human life is nothing but an algorithm, so in principle can be calculated, can be programmed, then it's only a matter of computational power before you can create robots, machines, which will completely emulate human beings, right? And then he makes a point that we know that the computing power is growing exponentially. So therefore, in not so distant future, and that's how he's basing, what he's basing his estimates on, in not so distant future, we will get to that point called singularity, right? But the premise here is that life is an algorithm, that human is a machine, you see. And so now there is one issue, which is why somebody like him or others who say that, and there are many people, unfortunately, especially in the Silicon Valley industry, let's just say, in the computing industry, in the big companies such as Google and Facebook, etc. Why do so many people believe that? What makes them believe? And second, what can I say as a scientist, as a mathematician, to help others who are not scientists or mathematicians, who are kind of watching this, some in amusement, some in disdain, with disdain, you know, what can I say to indicate the fallacy of this idea? So these are the two major questions for me. And maybe as far as the second question is that, what these ideas betray is ignorance. And as far as the first question is to me, is what the reason why these ideas are so entrenched now is fear. So it's really an interesting combination of fear and ignorance that drives the leaders of our technological world, many, not all, but many of them who are on record saying these kind of things. That's what I believe drives them, fear and ignorance. Now, as far as ignorance, what is essential to these ideas is the understanding that every object, every organism is the sum of its parts. In other words, a human is just a bag of elementary particles. Some of them actually say that in these words, in so many words. The universe is just a specially arranged collection of elementary particles. It's a direct quote from one of famous physicists. And he would know that that is a complete fabrication. That's what a physicist could say in the times of Descartes, 400 years ago, in 17th century, or perhaps in 18th century, perhaps even in 19th century. Laplace was famous for saying that a supreme intelligence who would know the positions of every particle and their velocities would know the evolution of the universe all the way into the future. But with the advent of quantum mechanics, about 100 years ago, we know that this is, how do I say, to say that it's not true, it would be an understatement, that it is an illusion. It has nothing to do with the truth. We know that the world is uncertain. We know that the world is quantum. We know that there is Heisenberg uncertainty, which is, even in the picture of Laplace, which is a picture of classical mechanics, in order to know the evolution of, even if the world is a collection of elementary particles, to know the evolution, you need to know the positions at a given moment, but also velocities or momentum. But Heisenberg uncertainty principle tells you that you cannot know both at the same time. So how can somebody who thinks of themselves as a scientist, how could they perpetrate this type of ignorant ideas? You know, it's not okay. And I think it's not okay because they're confusing a lot of people. It is okay to love science and to profess your love for science and your love for rationality. That's perfectly fine. But then don't be so selective. If you actually love science, find out what science actually says. Not science of the 19th century, but at least science of the 20th century. So that's the first. The closely related to this is the idea that the brain can be completely described by neural networks. In other words, there are neurons, and there are synapses between them. And this is completely mathematically described by this sort of a graph, which is how all consciousness is created. Now, look, yes, it is one way to speak about it. It highlights one aspect of the functioning of the brain. But we know very well that this is not complete. It's not a complete description of the function of the brain. C. elegans, a little worm, which is 1 millimeter long, has 302 neurons, and they have been completely described and all the synapses between them by neuroscientists. And neuroscientists themselves, the head of Allen Institute for Neuroscience, Koch, has said, we have no idea how the nervous system of the C. elegans functions, even though we have a complete map of the neurons. 302 neurons, and human brain has hundreds of billions of neurons. So it just shows you the scale of the problem. And look at other issues in neuroscience. The so-called binding problem, that yes, you know, in the brain, for instance, right now I'm looking at you, I can pick up the color of your shirt, I can pick up various features and so on. And we can correlate each of those with particular regions in the brain. But we still don't know. We have no clue how this information comes together to create a particular image. It's called a binding problem. Google it to find out. Now, or the stability problem of vision. Why is it that when I move my head, I still, unlike a camera, which would give a kind of a jerky picture, like a jerky film, I see a stable picture. Obviously something's happening in the brain. Neurosciences have no idea how this happens. So this is just a few examples. And so now, my point is you can only pretend that the human is a machine if you are subscribing to the idea that a human is a bunch of particles, a brain is a bunch of neurons, which contradicts everything we know today about science. It's nothing to do with spirituality. It's nothing to do with love. It is hardcore science, which is, you know, it's not that far away. And especially information so widely available today. Just Google it. That's sort of my advice to singularians and transhumanists. Go Google that. Find out the fallacy of these ideas. Find out how ignorant this is, how much this contradicts reality. And that takes the floor of just from under all these people, all these ideas, right? So that to me is, and yet these people are writing books about the subject, confusing everybody else, pretending that they are experts and who understand, confusing the public, but they don't address these issues. You see, they don't address quantum. And I will tell you, there is this company which was bought by Google 2 years ago, which is called DeepMind. And 2 years ago, Google paid £400 million for this company, more or less $600 million. And I just read recently a profile of the founder of this company, Demis Hassabis, who seems to be a very, sympathetic guy, very genuine, interesting, kind of a cool guy, in The Guardian. But it's incredible to me how these people, how selective they are in the kind of ideas that they are subscribing to and propagating through interviews, through media, and so on. So, for instance, he says the brain is purely computational, and this is sort of like an established fact. He says, I talked to the top biologist, and the consensus is that the brain has no quantum effects. Well, excuse me. I mean, this is a height of ignorance. This is a height of ignorance because even, just do a very small search and you find even algae are the seaweed are known now, the experiments have shown, are capable of turning on and off quantum coherence between their cells to manage the intake of energy in different situations, in different environments. They start acting as quantum objects and as classical ones. Algae, a little seaweed, okay? There are plenty of works about quantum. Besides, anyone who knows anything about quantum knows how big a role consciousness and the observer plays in measurement in quantum mechanics. This goes back to the great physicists of the 20th century, such as Niels Bohr and Eugene Wigner and John von Neumann, and Werner Heisenberg, all Nobel Prize winners, right? And now for this kid to come and say there is no link between consciousness and quantum, that's just pure and simple ignorance.